Hello.
Hello.
Okay. You said you were a ballerina.
Yes.
Can you talk a little more about that?
Yeah, that was way back in the Disney. Yes, good job, Jose. Good job. I started out at like 3 years old. I was the oldest, and so my parents were like, let's find something that she enjoys, woo! So they made me do a little bit of everything, but I was really stupid young. So like, here's ice skating, and I just sat and cried on the ice the whole time, because I'm like, who makes a three-year-old ice skate? But I found ballet, and I really enjoyed ballet, and so I studied ballet for years, and hi, Mira! For years and years and years and years. And when I was 12, this is going to sound like a really bad story or really sad story, but it's not, I promise. When I was 12, I went to a roller skating rink, and a little girl fell in front of me, and so I jumped to get over her and landed on my knee and tore ligaments in my knee, which as a ballerina means no more professional career. So I was pretty devastated, but I was like, I'm going to turn this into a positive. And so I started thinking of other ways that I could perform, because I really loved performing for people. And I found theater, because I could do musical theater and I could use my dance training in musical theater. And I liked to sing. I don't know if I'm any good at it, but I like to try. So I did that for years, and that's kind of what got me into theater. And then once I found theater, that was a better match. Because like, oh, now I don't have to be quiet. Because in ballet, they're mean. That if you talk at a turn, you'll get a whap. We used to get whaps on the hand with a ruler. Yeah, this was like straight up. This was serious ballet, you guys. So yeah, I was very careful about not being too loud and crazy. But then once I found theater, that kind of opened the door to the crazy Monica. And she hasn't disappeared since, so... But yeah, so that's why I get so excited. Like, there's a picture of Yukari Sendo from Rosario Plus Vampire where she's in a tutu and everything. And I'm like, ah! I always get excited when I see that photo. And that's actually how I met Christopher Ayers. We've been friends for probably longer than some of you have been alive. But I met him because we were doing theater together, and I was a dancer, and he was not, but he was really good at choreography. Like, he knew what he wanted to see people do, but he didn't know how to do it. So he'd have me do the actual dance steps. And so I worked with him as an assistant choreographer for like 6 years or something like that.
Assistant choreographer?
Yeah. Wow. So basically that means he goes, okay, I want this number to look like this. I want these people to do that. And how do I make that happen? And I go, oh, okay, you're going to do this, this, that, 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 that. And 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. And that's pretty much how I went. That's how I met a lot of the voice actors that I work with now, like Jessica Calvello. We were Hyatt and Excel in Excel Saga, and I met her the first time teaching her dance numbers because she was auditioning for a chorus line, and I was the dance instructor. So I actually taught her how to do like tap time steps, and that's how I first met her. And little did I know that we'd be working in anime together like so many years later. So it's funny how it works out. But yeah, I used to dance, still do a little, but I'm lazy. So I can still do it, and I do it around the house. I find that when I drink too much, that's when the ballet comes out. Yeah. Yes, ma'am. You look so cute.
Thank you. So my question for you is, anything about Black Butler season 3?
I don't think I can say anything about that. I don't know what I'm allowed to say because I'm just a stupid voice actor. Maybe?
I will.
ask Ian. He's better at saying things. That's the only thing about having cameras in the room is like, if there were no cameras, I'd be like, but ah, bah, bah. But there's cameras, so I'm cautious. Hi.
Hello. This is more of a general question. I thought of it because I was thinking of how Majestic Prince, which you worked on, doesn't do that. What do you think of like the current trend in anime that, especially in this like post-Madoka world, where like the show starts out kind of happy-go-lucky, but then halfway through it just goes like, optimism? What's that?
I kind of dig that because I did a lot of Shakespeare for a long time, mm-hmm. And so I love me a good tragedy. So I kind of think it's fun, and as an actor, it kind of gives you something to work with, because if everything's happy-go-lucky all the time, then there's no conflict. It's like, well, so it's nice to kind of have that inner conflict. Now, sometimes it's a little too abrupt, you know, and it's hard to get your character to like catch up to the craziness that ensues. But usually I'm all for it. I like to have a little mix of both.
I just liked Majestic Prince a lot because it did, it started out pretty comedic, but it got dramatic, you know,
oh, yeah.
The show went on. But it never lost the fact that these are nice, these are good kids doing good things and succeeding at it instead
yeah.
of failing because grimdark.
Yeah, it's a great show. It's funny because there's another show Brett brought up earlier to get a sign called Rumbling Hearts. Ooh. And Lucy Christian and I play kind of the comic relief, but we thought it was a comedy because we had no idea what the rest of the show was about. And when somebody was like, oh my God, you know, that's not a comedy. I was like, this that happens and that happens. And it's like worse, worse, worse. It's like one giant country song. Like it just gets worse. Oh, the life is terrible. And then I was like, oh gosh, so I guess we are just the comic relief, but everything we do is so fun and happy and lighthearted. I was like, oh, what a cute show. They're like, that's not a cute show. It's a very dark, dramatic show. I'm like, oh, well, I wouldn't have known. So I like things like that where they mix the two because, too, you don't want it to be so, you know, sad and dramatic all the time. And then some people like to have a little bit of drama, so you don't want it to be too happy-go-lucky all the time either. So I did it. No problem. Thank you. Hello.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm good today.
Awesome.
Just a quick question. It's kind of... I don't know if it's going to be hard for you or whatever.
Bring it. I like a challenge.
If you pick, bring up three roles, if you pick up three roles you loved doing, mm-hmm. at, like top, whatever, how many, because I know you've been in the business for a long time, what would it be? I don't know, it's kind of like, I don't know, generic or whatever.
No, it's not generic. It's always, that's always the toughest question. And I always tell people that like picking your favorites is like picking your favorite children. It's really hard to do. And it's doubly hard for me because I play so many cool characters. Like, I've gotten so many awesome ones.
Just three off the top of your head?
I'd say I'll go with the newer ones because new ones are always fun. So we've got Sig in Gangsta is a new favorite of mine. Yona in Yona the Dawn is another big favorite. And Rize in Tokyo Ghoul. Those are my newest favorites.
Thank you.
No problem. Hi. How are you?
Hi. I'm good. Thanks.
What's up?
I'm actually a huge fan of Princess Jellyfish.
I love Princess Jellyfish. I just got goosebumps.
And I was wondering what your inspiration was for voicing Maya.
Maya, for me, it was all about just watching her because the way they animated that show was absolutely beautiful. And I listened to the Seiyu before we would record, and my usual shtick as a voice actor is I listen to the Seiyu, kind of get a grasp of what they did, and then I do, like, the Monica take, which is usually 10 times. Like, I take it a little bit farther. And I thought she was so fun, and the character with all the arm movements and stuff. So I was actually in the booth, and anytime Maya was doing her crazy movements or whatever, I was doing the same movements. And what was fun is that Chris Bevins and I have worked together for a long time. He was the director of Jellyfish, and he kind of just let it roll. So a lot of times, like in the background, when in the Japanese she wasn't doing anything, I'd be back there like making noises, and they kept a lot of that in because they were like, it's fun and doesn't pull from the scene, and she's in the background. And so yeah, I had a blast working on Maya. When I first auditioned, I was like, I don't know if it's a boy or a girl, and I love it. I have no idea what's going on. And when I did that audition, I was like, oh my gosh, I'm gonna be so sad if I don't get this role because I absolutely love her. So I was very lucky. But yeah, I love Maya. Yeah. Thank you. Hi. How are you?
Good. Do you like to voice Renge from Orin High School Host Club?
I do. I love Renge. Renge is usually the one that when I go to conventions, people are like, oh my God, you sound just like Renge. And I'm like, wasn't trying too hard to mask my voice. I love Renge too because I worked on the scripts for Oran. I used a pseudonym because I was worried that everybody would hate it and I didn't want them to hate me. So I was like, hey, if they hate it, they'll hate Dorothy Garrett. Woo! So now that everybody likes it, I'm like, sweet, I can actually say that I wrote that. But I felt like I cheated because it was like I wrote all of those episodes, and then when I went into audition, so I actually knew what the laugh was supposed to sound like. I knew the character a little bit better than everybody else. So I kind of feel like I cheated, but at the same time, like, I can't imagine not playing that role. Like, I had such a blast, and I took, like, every time I met, you know, a crazy fangirl at a convention or a cute fangirl at a convention, or I would take little bits and pieces from the people that I met at conventions and use that for Renge. So it's actually an homage to all of you ladies. Only you guys are much cooler and chiller than Renki could ever be. But yes, I absolutely loved it. I wish there would be more Auron someday.
Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, how are you, sweetheart?
Good. Can I ask a two-part question?
Yes.
When you record in the booth, do you find it better with the beeps, or is there an experience where you did it without the beeps?
Ooh, good question. So for those of you that don't know, like, there are two ways to record or dub, you know, anime. Usually at places like Sentai or ADV, they do what's called the chase method. And what that means is we'll watch the whole scene in Japanese, and then you just go back to the beginning, and you actually just speak when it's your turn. So it's you talking to the Japanese, which for some people is really hard to even grasp. I loved it because it taught me kind of timing, and I knew, okay, well, I came in for this line late, so if I make it later, then they'll be able to just go, boop, and it'll fit perfectly. With Funimation, they use what's called the beep system, and that's pretty regular for, like, LA, too. So you get beep, 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 and then you speak on the imaginary fourth beep, so you know exactly when to come in and when to get out. The problem with that is I kind of prefer the chase method because it's more organic. Like, you're not... You'll find a lot of new actors sometimes because of the beeps. That first word that they say will be really sped up, or it'll be like, I'm saying my line, because they're like, oh my God, that's my cue. As you do it more, you get more accustomed to it. But I tend to prefer the chase method just because it's very like, okay, I'm going to say this line. And even though I don't understand Japanese, there are other people there talking to me. Because if you're the first person to record, you don't hear anyone. So at least there's some Japanese around you and stuff. At Funimation, you'll just hear the elements, so you'll hear the sounds that are happening, but you won't hear the characters talking. So, and I think that it's made me faster at the beat method because I have learned that way. So there's pros and cons to both, but I like the other
one. And then the second one is, what's your favorite bomb that someone's left for you in the booth, or your favorite one that you've left for someone else?
I'm so bad about bombs because I get into the booth and I'm focused. I'm like, I have to do my job because I have ADHD and I don't like to take medicine. So when I get into the booth, I have to like focus. I'm like, okay, I'm going to do my job. So they don't like leaving bombs for me because 9 times out of 10, I don't even hear them because I'm so focused on what I'm doing. I know I left some bombs for Aaron Dismuke on Corpse Princess, but I couldn't for the life of me remember what they were. I've known Aaron since he was 8 years old, so I like to mess with him a lot because now he's like 7 foot tall and it's really discerning. He's really tall and skinny and he used to be 8. So yeah, I feel like an old lady. He makes me feel old. But I can't remember any off the top of my head. Usually it's just, there's a lot of curse words that happen because, you know, you're trying to make things fit and it doesn't fit. And I used to curse a lot, but now I find what I'll do is if I screw up, it's more of like blah, 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 blah. I'll just fill the flaps with chicken noises or whatever come in. They're like, what are you doing? I'm like, it's been a long day. But thank you. If I remember any, I will let you know, but I'm bad about that. Hello, Taj.
Hello. Okay, I have 2 questions for you.
Go for it.
All right, now, first off, you voiced recently Tokyo Ghoul, as well as the script adapter.
Yes.
Can you talk about what that was like working on it?
I loved doing the scripts for Tokyo Ghoul. So I had worked on Fairy Tail for like 4 years straight, which I love me some Fairy Tail. Woohoo! I loved working on Fairy Tail. But after 4 years in the Grand Magic Games, I was like, I think I need to work on something else. And so I told John, I was like, hey, you know, the Fairy Tail crew's got it. Is there any way that I can kind of like work on something else? And then if you need me to go back to Fairy Tail, I will. And he's like, well, I've got this show and I was actually going to talk to you about it. It's called Tokyo Ghoul. And I'd heard about Tokyo Ghoul and I was like, okay, sweet, I'll check it out. Actually, he gave me a choice between that and Dragonar Academy. And I went, Tokyo Ghoul. I'm sure Dragonar is great, but I want the dark, bloody show.
Yeah, and you, sure enough, you chose the dark one.
Yeah, I wanted the dark, meaty show. So I took the dark, meaty show, and I loved it. It was a pain in the butt sometimes because there was so much nuance in it that it was hard to convey at times. But I spent a lot of time really making sure that everything was true to the characters and true to what was being said. And then I fell in love with Rize. And I've never, ever in my life asked to audition for a certain character, but I was mentioning, I was like, so Mike, I don't ever do this, but I'd really like to audition. He's like, oh, for Hitomi, for the little girl. And I was like, and he goes, What? I was like, actually, I wanted to audition for Rize. And he goes, oh, I was just gonna cast you as Rize. And I was like, because that's not usually the kind of role that Mike would think of me for. So I was very excited, and knowing everything about her because of the writing really helped. And she's so deliciously evil and awesome. It was nice getting to play the two sides that I get to play a lot, but doing it in a much more malicious way. That was fun. And also the having scenes with Sabbat, we were in so many shows together. I mean, like, he's my brother in Fairy Tale. He's my husband in Dragon Ball. He's my butler in Shin Chan. So we've had all of these different relationships, and to be like enemies in that first part was really a lot of fun to get to play that dynamic. But I love that show. If you guys have not seen Tokyo Ghoul, I cannot recommend it enough. It's a great show.
I second that.
Woohoo! What's your second question?
Okay. Now, the second one's going to be a little different.
I like it.
I'm not sure if many people know about this, but you worked on an e-manga project called Magical Dreamers.
Yes.
Can you talk about that if you can?
I don't know what I can say about it other than we did it. I think it's available. I don't know. It was the weirdest thing. These people came from Japan, and they're like, hey, we're going to do this e-manga, and it's going to be this awesome app, and people are going to be able to read the manga, but then it'll also have a track where the voices just play so that you don't actually have to read the manga. I mean, like, you can look at the manga and then hear the voices. And so Chris, again, and I worked on that, and we recorded the whole thing, and Brina, and then they disappeared. So I know it's out there. I don't know. I'm sure you can download it. It's called Magical Dreamers. It's really fun. I know they've got, like, extras with me and Chris being silly and talking and stuff. But I couldn't tell you where to download it because I never got that information.
Fair enough. Thank you.
Thank you, Sadie. Hello, Brett.
Hi there. One question. Since so many fans nowadays only really know about, like, the newest shows that have come out, like, the last 4 or 5 years, what is something from, say, 15 years ago that you worked on that you would recommend other people check out? Like, say, Princess Nine?
Oh, yeah, good question. Princess Nine is definitely one of my top shows. It was the first show where I tell people, like, that's where I learned how to voice act. Like, before that, it was kind of still feeling out the waters and trying to figure out this whole new thing that I was doing. I'd been an actor for years, but I was so green in the beginning that I had no idea what I was doing. And I feel like Princess Nine is the first time I was like, I get it. I totally get it now. And it was such a good show. It's a show about baseball, but it's not really about baseball, if that makes sense. It's about a girls' team, and it's all about the girls. And I love character-driven shows. I love it when it's all about the relationships. So that's one. Excel Saga, if you guys haven't seen Excel Saga, like, it's the granddaddy to all the crazy anime. It's like Panty and Stockings, like, long-lost grandmother. It's kind of the original for all the crazy animes that you see today. Corral Phantom Memory is one that not a lot of people have seen. That's a really beautiful, deep story. Razafon. Gosh, there's so many. If you've seen Full Metal Alchemist and you haven't seen Full Metal Panic, boo on you. You have to see Full Metal Panic is fun. It's totally different, but it's totally fun. But yeah, those are some. And if you guys ever have, I'm pretty good about, like, if you ever have any, like, if you want suggestions, if you let me know, like, what kind of stuff you're into, I can throw stuff at you usually. So, but those are the big ones, I'd say. Thanks, Brad. Good question. Hello. How are you, sir?
Good. Hi.
What's up?
Is there anything super new for Dragon Ball Z, another movie besides the new one?
I don't know how much I can talk about. Resurrection F is out. There is a new Dragon Ball show called Dragon Ball Super.
Can you do the voice for that?
Whether or not we have it, I don't know.
Okay.
What else can I say? I think I don't know whether there's going to be another movie or not, but I will say that it looks like they're kind of amping up to do one a year. That is just me hypothesizing. Please don't quote me on that. The new thing has been to quote Monica Rial on Twitter and say that I confirmed things. I am not confirming that there is a new movie, but I would imagine that since it's been yearly and they're doing so well. I mean, Resurrection F was the number 5 film in the United States for a while in limited release. Like, that's crazy. So I think that they're probably going to strike while the iron's hot, and I would be really surprised if there wasn't another movie next year.
Thank you.
No problem, sweetie. Hello. Hi. What's up?
All right. First thing, you mentioned Full Metal Panic. I don't know if you were made aware, but third season has been confirmed.
What?
Yeah.
I just got goosebumps again. Shut up, really?
Yeah, happened yesterday.
Oh, I can't wait to play Kyoko. Oh, they better let me play Kyoko again.
So that's one.
Okay, awesome.
Two, a friend of mine that met you up north told me to ask about Aqua Teen Hunger Force and your experience.
Yay! Oh, that's awesome. Okay, so I was on Aqua Teen Hunger Force, and I played a character named Jubilee. She was kind of a Dora the Explorer knockoff, and she became friends with Meatwad under the guise of teaching him Spanish. And she was there with her knapsack and her GPS, named Knapsack and GPSy. And it turns out that she's really like part of a gang of pornographers. And they're trying to get Meatwad, because they do this whole thing about stealing people's virginity, and so they're trying to get Meatwad to yeah. And then Shake comes in and Carl, and they ruin everything. But what's funny is that I didn't know how they contacted me. Like, I'm in Dallas, they're in Atlanta, and it was so random. Like, one day my agent calls and goes, somebody called and wants you to audition for Aqua Teen? She's like, what is this? I was like, yes, I will audition for that. And so I immediately thought, oh, it must have been Dana Schneider, because I've been coming to Animate for years with Dana. And I was like, oh, you must have said something to somebody or whatever. So I saw Dana yesterday, and I was like, oh my God, thanks for, you know, helping me out. And he goes, that wasn't me. I mean, I'll take the credit, but I don't think maybe I did. I was like, I wonder, I don't know. So somebody magically, and I assumed that, I thought that they might have been an anime fan, whoever suggested, because they knew things about me that Dana wouldn't know. Like, they knew that I spoke Spanish, and they knew that I had been in all these anime, and they knew that I had done these things. And I'm like, Dana doesn't know any of that. So I don't know how it happened, but it was super fun, and it's kind of inspired me to start looking for more Western animation and stuff. Because it was fun. As much as I love my anime, it was great to not have lip flaps. I was like, oh my God, I get to just act. I don't have to worry about like fitting the flaps. This is awesome. So yeah, I had a blast. It was so much fun. Okay. Thank you. Hello, sir.
Hello again.
What's up?
Okay. This next question is a hypothetical one.
Okay.
You can ask this one any way you want to.
Ooh. Okay.
All right. Now, if you were given the opportunity to like go back and re-record one of your earlier shows, which one would you do and why?
Gasaraki. That was easy. I would do Gasaraki. Here's why. My very first show I ever worked on was a little show called Martian Successor Nadeshko, way back in the day. And I played this little bitty character, and I did a lot of bit parts. So that's kind of how I learned. But like right after that, like literally, I went in and did that for the first time, and I was cast as the lead in Gasaraki, and I had no idea what I was doing. Like absolutely no clue. In fact, so little that the very first session for Gasaraki, my very first line was to scream no and like scream it. Being an actor, I was totally fine with that, but I wasn't used to a microphone. So Matt Greenfield was like, okay, so I need you to scream it. And I'm like, all right. No! And he goes, What are you doing? I'm like, I'm screaming it, but there's a microphone right there. He goes, no, we take care of that. Like, you just scream. And so it took me 45 minutes to comprehend that I didn't have to, because I was worried, because my voice has hurt people's ears before. Sorry, all of you, because I'm sure it's done it at least once. And so I told them, I was like, if I scream, it's going to hurt you. It's going to be loud. And they were like, just do it. And I got so frustrated finally. I was like, no! And Matt was like, good. Okay, now we can move on. And it clicked. I was like, oh, okay. And I watched some of that stuff, and it's not that it's terrible. It's just that if I had known then what I know now, like I always say, it wasn't until Princess Nine and Noir that I really figured out what I was doing. So still for like Gasaraki and Generator Gall, those are the two where I was trying to figure out how this whole voice acting thing works. So yeah, I would love to go back and redo Gasaraki just to do it again.
Good answer.
Thank you.
All right. This other one's actually largely related to voice acting, period.
Mm-hmm.
As you also worked on video games. Can you talk about what it's like working on gaming compared to working on anime?
Well, what's fun about gaming is you don't have any parameters to work around unless it's a Japanese game or a game in another language. Then what they'll do is they'll play the line and you just have to match the timing, but you can read it however you want. But working on something like, say, Smite, you know, I just go in there and I read everything however I want to, and they'll be like, okay, more dark and evil or more happy and light. And I just go through and do back and forth. And it's weird because sometimes, like, I didn't even know, I knew what hell was, Norse mythology and all that, but I didn't know what she looked like. I didn't have a picture or anything to go by. And it wasn't until I saw the trailers for Smite that I was like, oh, she's hot. Like, she's totally cool. Like, she's badass. Like, one side of her is all dark and crazy, and the other side's all sweet and wispy. But you don't know that. Like, when I went in for Borderlands 2, they literally gave me a picture of a gun, and they were like, that's you. And I'm like, what? What do you mean? What do you want me to do? Like, pew, pew. I don't understand. I don't understand. And they're like, oh, no, these guns have voices, and this is the thing. And so then we kind of played with the voice and figured out. And that gun was supposed to have, like, one line, and because we had so much fun doing it, it ended up having, like, 20-something lines. And it's actually a good gun, which is great. I like it.
Yeah, all the world priestly nagging you for killing somebody.
Well, you know, of course. I got to give everybody a hard time. But, yeah, it's different worlds, but it's kind of, it's more liberating because you get to make more choices. You kind of get to, I love voice acting, but I call it math acting because you have to think about the voice you're using and the motivation of the character and all of these other things and then match those horrible flaps, which sometimes are great and sometimes are not so great, and it was very obviously the C team in Korea that just decided to go, oh, mom, 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 and those are impossible to make look good.
Wow.
Yeah, but thank you. Yeah, I love it. Both are fun, but I like the video games and anime for different reasons.
Thank you very much. Gosh.
Hello, sir.
All right, well, I don't know how people get, I really like one of your characters and really dislike another character. I'll start with the one I don't like as much.
Okay.
Because I'll give you a clue. He's very full of himself and a little bit arrogant. Black Star, you know.
Oh, that's not me.
Oh.
That's Brittany. I'm Tsubaki.
Oh, good. Oh, yeah. all right. No problem. Well, the other thing is, like, Shizuki.
Oh, Shizuka from High School of the Dead?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. Is she really as bubbly as it from the Japanese? You know, I'm not. I know that they don't do exact translations anymore.
Right.
So do they like kind of like change the personalities when they?
In all honesty, yeah. I will tell you, like, when we recorded High School of the Dead, it was at a period when Sentai was just kind of coming about, like they weren't really a big company. So we worked really, really fast. So I recorded all of High School of the Dead in like 6 hours. So I really didn't have the luxury of listening to the Japanese and going, oh, okay, this is what she sounded like. I just went with it. Because they kind of threw me in a booth and went, all right, so you're that big busted blonde nurse, go. And I'm like, oh, okay. So I have no idea. I mean, maybe someday I'll have the time to go back and watch the Japanese, but I haven't had the time. But so I'm not sure. I couldn't tell you, honestly.
And I just got like one request. I want to hear a quote from Shizuki. You know, could you do a Shizuki?
Here's the problem with quotes is unless you've got one for me, we don't memorize anything. So it's, unless it's like a Satan soul or a repent mother trucker or something like that. Those are so easy to remember. But usually she was just a whole lot of, I remember that. Thank you. Right. Hello. You look so dapper today. Look at
Hello.
You.
As you know, like through cons, like you're always going to get stuff to autograph, and usually it's the popular stuff like Dragon Ball Z, Fairy Tail. But what's it like when you get the more obscure stuff like Princess Jellyfish or Okami-san?
It's awesome. Like every once in a while, people will bring out like some random awesomeness. Yeah, like he brought me Lux Payne earlier, which I was like, oh my God, how did you? And it was a little tiny game card. So yeah, it's fun to see the older stuff too. Like there was a convention I was at recently where somebody brought Sister Princess. And I was like, holy crap, I almost forgot that was a thing. And they were like, you don't remember what character you were. And I'm like, Sakuya. So it's fun to see those and revisit. I recently went to Hawaii to a convention there, and there was a gentleman named Sheldon who's precious, and he had like just like bags full of like suitcases full of anime, and he's like, I don't want to make you sign all of it. And I'm like, oh, I'll sign it. And it was great. It was like walking through memory lane of your career, because he had so much. And I was like, holy crap, Jinky Extend. I haven't seen that show in forever. Or what were some of the other ones? You know, he had Steel Angel Kurumi and like all these things. I'm like, oh my God, I haven't seen these shows in forever. So yeah, I love seeing some of the old stuff too.
And also, what was it? I don't fully remember her name, but I think it was like Mayama from Princess Jellyfish.
Oh, Maya, yeah.
Yeah, Maya. What was it like voicing such a... Third.
Totally awesome. I loved her. I wish I knew more about the actual Three Kingdoms. I spoke to somebody yesterday where I was like, I have no idea. I hope what I was saying was correct. And she goes, oh yeah, my friend was in it. And she totally was in it. I'm like, okay, good. As long as I sound like I know what I'm talking about. But I loved Maya. Yeah. It was literally my, like I could do whatever I wanted. Bevins was really sweet about just letting me be crazy and going for it. So she was fun.
Thank you.
No problem. Hello, sir.
Recently, it's like I've been watching The World God Only Knows.
Oh, yeah.
In a lot of the sites, they have you listed as playing Luna, who had, I think, one line total at the start of an episode of, I think, season one. But then you also did the Library Club president
music
in 3-4 episodes, and she's uncredited on like all these sites.
Yeah.
How much does that annoy you when you go, it's like,
I guess for me, it's like I never know what's credited and what isn't. So it's funny to me because there's a lot of people who are like, I watched all of that show and paid attention to the credits and I had no idea you were in there. And I'm like, ah. Because they don't always, like, even especially with the broadcast stubs, they don't have time to put everybody's names in there. Like, even with the writers, I feel bad because I know the lead writers get listed and the actual writers of the episodes don't always get listed. And I'm like, that sucks because they are the ones that worked hard. We just spell checked it and turned it in. But yeah, sometimes on stuff like that, especially with Sentai when it was really early, they had a hard time about putting things. Like, if you weren't a main character, chances are you weren't even going to be listed.
Like additional voices.
Yeah, additional voices, which is, to me, it's fine. Like, at this point, like, I just want to, I want to break 500 just so I can say I did. But at this point, I'm like, I've got so many, like, if I kept tab, like, I had an ex that was really into, like, keeping tabs for me. He's like, okay, now you're at 362. And I'm like, dude, really? It's not that big a deal. I just love what I do. And so I don't care as much about the credits as long as they keep hiring me.
Yes, like if it had been like your first couple of roles, then it's like,
yeah.
Yeah, it's like,
if it had been my first thing that I'd ever done and they didn't give me credit, I probably would have been a little butthurt because it's your first thing you ever did. You know, I would have wanted to have my name out there for that. But now I'm kind of like, I'm old hat. Like, let the newbies get their name on there. I'm good. Everybody will know it's me anyway because you guys, all I have to do is go, and people are like, oh, that's Monica Rial. And I'm like, all right, sweet. But I love it. You guys are awesome. Thank you. Hello, sir.
Hello.
Drink some soda.
Hello.
You're getting serious. I like it.
I'm very new to anime, and I'm very interested in, you know, watching a lot of different, like, cultures and such of that genre.
Mm-hmm.
Out of, you know, 1-5, what would you recommend me to watch?
Now, what have you seen?
I've seen a few episodes of Dragon Ball, and I've seen the whole entire series of Full Metal Alchemist.
Okay. Now, so you like kind of the darker, mysterious stuff?
I mean,
or?
For me, Full Metal Alchemist was a bit of between because I kind of like the way that they talk about immortality and stuff.
Right.
But at the same time, you know, there were some goofy moments. And
okay. All right, I'm going to give you my list that I give to most people who are just kind of starting out. Some of them might not be your style, but give them a try.
Nothing
and see.
Too goofy, though.
Okay.
Because my friend recommended me Dog Days. I watched like a few episodes. I didn't like it.
I'll give you Panty and Stocking. That one is crazy.
Wait one moment.
Huh?
I need to take out my
phone.
Oh,
yeah, yeah. Take your notes. Yeah. Notes. Panty and Stocking is foul. There's a lot of four-letter words. There's a lot of poop humor. There's a lot of, what else should I warn him? If you're easily offended, don't do it. If you're offended by sexual stuff, don't watch it.
I'm not.
Okay, good. that's usually a good one to start. There's a lot of people who that's been their gateway anime, shall we say. And it's nice and short. It's nice little 15-minute episodes. So if it's not your game, then all you have to do is watch a couple episodes and go, and I'm done. So it's called Panty and Stocking with Garter Belt, but you just need to know Panty and Stocking.
I mean, that might lead me to a different side, don't you think?
Just look it up on, like, Right Stuff or Funimation. Don't go looking that up on Google. Yeah. If you do, look up Panty and Stocking anime. Make sure you leave that anime part. Another one I would give you would be Tokyo Ghoul. Is a good one to start out with. I'm trying to think, like, what's anime but not too anime is to scare somebody new off. Soul Eater would probably be a good one. It's got a fun anime style. It's
God, I can't even keep it up.
It's 52 episodes, so that's kind of daunting, but not quite as daunting as some of the other ones. I'm not going to give you any One Piece or any
What's
of that.
What's the third recommendation?
The third one, Tokyo Ghoul. Did you get that one?
Tokyo Ghoul. Tokyo Ghoul.
And then, oh, a Soul Eater.
Leader?
Eater. Like. It sounds really dark and depressing, but it's really not. I'm trying to think gateway animes. You guys help me out here. What's another good gateway?
I was going to say Danganronpa, but.
Which?
But I would maybe prefer the game.
Yeah, you'd have to play the game first. Though that might be too long. Let's think of some shorter stuff. That way he can see quite a few.
I'm surprised that I'm not being slaughtered by you guys because I thought you guys would like rip me
no,
to shreds.
This is what I love about anime fans is that they're not like that. They're like, oh, you're interested? You want to be one of us? Here, let us help you.
Yes.
So what is your name?
Ricardo.
Ricardo. Okay, everybody, this is Ricardo. Everybody say hi, Ricardo. Show them how awesome we are. If you have a favorite anime or something that you think that Ricardo needs to watch, will you at some point find him and let him know what it is that you think is
Enlighten me.
Huh?
Enlighten me.
Exactly. Enlighten him. Tell him what your favorite is. Oh, Baccano is a good one. B-A-C-C-A-N-O.
Wait, what?
B-A?
B-A?
C-C?
C-C?
A-N-O?
A-N-O.
And I'm going to give you a really weird one. It's new. But I think you might dig it because it's so totally different. It's called Ninja Slayer. It's crazy, but it just might be your kind of crazy. Michiko Hatchin is a good one too, but it's on Toonami right now, and I tell you to watch it, but we're like at the end. So
well,
that was
I really enjoyed sometimes
good.
Watching Toonami.
Oh, good. Well, then, as long as you're into those shows, then those shouldn't scare you. But yeah, if you guys can think of anything else, find Ricardo and let him know.
Thank you. I really appreciate this.
No problem, sweetie. No worries. Everybody here is, you'll find that the anime crowd is very, very welcoming. It's not, there's no judgment.
I kind of felt like I was in the National Geographic. I was like, I am in foreign grounds.
No.
I don't know where I am.
It doesn't take long before you're one of us. Just accept it.
I will.
Right. Thank you, hon.
Appreciate it.
No problem. Hey, sweetie.
Hey, how's it going?
Good, you know. Hanging out, answering questions.
Stay.
What's up?
I just want to ask about Danganronpa, since you were in it, Sayaka. You're the walking spoiler, you know.
Yes.
How was it like working on there?
It was fun. I've never played the games. Like, I'm not a huge gamer. Like, I am all about Cookie Jam. Woo! That's as much of a gamer as I am. So I've never played the games, and I had never heard any of the other stuff. So it was all very new to me. But. I'm just not a gamer. I really suck at it. I'm a really, really, really bad gamer. So yeah, but I really enjoyed the character, and I think the show's really, really cool, and that would definitely be one I would suggest in the future.
So we have two Danganronpas here.
I love it.
You and Josh.
Yeah, that's right. Josh is in it. There's so many people in it.
That character is a dick.
Oh, well, dick. You know, it's Josh. No, I'm kidding. No, Josh is so super nice. Hey.
Another main question on my mind right now is, what are your thoughts on Index, both the character and the series?
I love the series. I wish that I showed up in Railgun more than she shows up in my show. but I love Index. I always say Index is kind of my inner child, like with the eating and the yelling and the biting. I also like to go up to Micah Solusad a lot and just go and watch him run away in fear. I love Index. She's absolutely totally fun. The only thing that I wish we had done, but the director made the decision, not me, is that she's originally from the UK. So I would have loved to have given her an accent just to make her that much more pretentious and crazy. But I totally understand why the director didn't want to have to keep tabs on that. So,
My other main question was, what are your thoughts on how like way back in the early days of ADV, how Chris Patton was kind of like the Johnny Yong Bosch of Houston, where he was the main character all the time?
He's brilliant. I mean, Chris Patton's got a fantastic voice.
I mean, I love that.
Oh yeah,
it's a really funny trend, is all.
Oh yeah, he was the lead character in everything for a long time, just because he's so good. And that's the thing, is when you're good and you're fast and you're professional, you find that you get a lot of work, and he's all of those things.
Yeah, I really liked both you and him in Razafon.
Oh, thank you. I love that show. That's a really good one. Thank you so much. Hi, guys. What's up?
Hi. Hi.
Hi.
So, we are two people, but we have two questions.
Okay, go for it.
So, I'm going to ask my first. How hard is it to voice act?
I'll be real, it's not easy. and I think that's why a lot of people, like, there are a lot of actors out there, like, when the studios are looking for more people, will be like, hey, let me call my actor friends. And you'll bring in 10 actors that have been doing it for years, that have been on Broadway, that have done film and all this stuff. And then they come in and they try to voice act and it just does not compute. You know, like, it just doesn't work. And then you'll find other people that are singers that have never really done any acting, but they're brilliant singers and musicians, and they come in and they nail it. So it's a very weird skill set, because there's so many things that you have to do at one time as an actor. So it can be tricky. And once you learn how to do it, it's easy. But it's the learning how to do it. Kind of like driving a stick. You know, does anybody drive a stick shift? Nobody does anymore, ever, huh? Yay, Mira. So, like, it's hard to learn, but then once you do it, you don't even think about it anymore, because you're just so used to doing it. That's the best analogy I can give. It's not easy. That being said, if you work hard at it, you can learn how to do it, and it becomes easier. What was your question, sweetie?
Did you enjoy working on Assassination Classroom?
Yes, I totally loved working on Assassination Classroom, and I'm totally stoked because Afia, who is one of the directors, told me what happens in the manga, and then when I found out there's a season 2, I'm like, oh yeah, maybe I'll have my chance. Maybe Kaede will get her moment, because up until this point, I've just been really cute and clueless, like, ah, hey, what's up, Nagisa, what's happening? And so I'm really excited for her to maybe have like a moment. That'd be fun. But yeah, I love it. I think Sunny Strait is brilliant. He is so good as Kuro Sensei. I love it. Thank you, ladies. Hello, how are you? You look fabulous.
Thank you. First of all, Riza, I would gladly let you take over my body.
Oh, really? Perhaps we should talk later.
And then I just want to know, your more recent things, like, mm-hmm. What's it like? You're gonna work on Seraph of the End, I hear.
Yes, I'm working on I'm Cruel in the first season, yeah. And so we're working on the second season. I don't think that's a surprise. Like, we're gonna be broadcast dubbing that as well. In fact, I just edited a script for 13 while I was here, so woo!
Yes.
So that'll be coming.
And then I'm really excited for Beyond the Boundary, too. Like, I just heard that that was dubbed, and I was just like, oh, my God.
It's such a good show. It was one of those sleeper hits that kind of came through, and everybody was like, hey, well, you want to be in the show and come down to Houston? I'm like, yeah, totally. I want to come be in the show and come down to Houston. I had no idea, like, what a great show it was until I started working on it, and it's really awesome. I like it.
Any news on the movie? Because I hear there's a movie that'll be dubbed.
I have no idea. I would... Tweet Sentai Filmworks, because they're really good at answering, and ask them and like push them, because if they know, they're really big about listening to the fandom. So you guys, if you tweet at Funimation and at Sentai, they actually do read those tweets and listen. Yeah, Sentai notice me. So yeah, if you tweet to them and ask about it and keep pushing about it, you know, hopefully if they know that fans actually want it, then they're more inclined to get it. So
awesome.
Hopefully.
Thank
I would
you
love
so
to
much.
Play Mitsuki again. I love her.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Hello.
Hello. I have one more question for
you. Sure.
Now, you say that you're into dark anime, right?
Yes.
Are there any other ones that you personally like?
Yes, my favorite anime of all time is a very dark movie called Perfect Blue. Or A Perfect Blue. Is there an A? I think there's an A. I think it's a Perfect Blue. It's an older film, but it's really creepy, and it's about a stalker and a woman kind of falling apart because of it. So if you're into creepy psychological drama, that's a good movie to watch. But yes, I like the dark stuff. I love my Dead Man Wonderlands, noir. I mean, I loved going into noir every week to figure out how Kirika was going to kill somebody. Like, I'm like, sweet, awesome. This week you've got guns and popcorn. Woo! So, yeah, I'm all about the dark stuff and the psychos. I love my psychos, too. Thanks, Todd.
Thank you.
Hello, sir.
Afternoon.
How are you?
Not too bad. First, I just want to say that when I was a kid, I wasn't much of an anime watcher. I was a bit of a casual.
Oh, cool.
But it was one day I was looking on demand, and I found one anime that was called Negima.
Oh, yay! Negima!
And that anime was the one that actually first got me into it.
Oh, fun.
And it's the one that I got all the mangas. It's the one I got all the anime.
Oh, fun.
And it's the first one that I saw you and Miss Jamie Marshy in.
Yes!
Way before the... Stalking and Panic.
Yes, way before.
Now, first off, I just want to say thank you because that was, I love that anime.
Oh, thank you.
Anytime I'm feeling down, I watch it. You as Konika always manage to make me smile.
Thank you. You're so sweet. Right.
And when it comes to the question, I just want to know, since there has been the release in Japan of the Negima movie, final movie.
Oh, I didn't even know that.
Well, then that answers my question. Whether or not it was going to make its way over here in the English.
It may. I mean, like, that's one of the things. Like, when it comes out in Japan, I'd like to say that usually if it's a show that we've done before and it's done really well, then 9 times out of 10, the company is going to, like, try to license that thing. Sometimes companies get weird and they're like, oh, this show did really well for Funimation. Maybe we should steal it out from under them, you know? I would hope that that doesn't happen because if somebody else dubbed Negima, that'd be kind of weird because we've done so many seasons of it and whatever. I would hope we get to do it. Maybe. I don't know anything because I'm a voice actor and they don't tell me. But I haven't worked on it yet, so I can tell you that.
Well, here's crossed. Hoping too. So you have
yes.
a good day.
Thank you. You too. Hello, hon.
Okay, so I really like Black Butler, and it's
yes.
my first like dub, but my first anime was free. But I was wondering if you could do the ding that Mayrin does.
Oh, yes. I can talk like Mayrin. She sounds like this. So easy. I don't even have to warm up. No, I don't. But she says, ding, like that. Yes. No problem. I love Mayrin. That's one of my favorite voices to do just because it's so ridiculous. And it was literally one where I listened to the seiyuu and went, that's cool. I'm going to do that times 10. And add a crazy accent. And they were like, sweet. And that's one thing I tell aspiring voice actors. I'm like, take chances. You know what I mean? Like, just go out on a limb. It's better, they always say in acting, it's better to go too far and be pulled back than to not go far enough. So like on May Rin auditioning for that, I'm sure everybody else went in and was like, I'm a very proper maid. Ah. And I went in and was like, I'm crazy. Oh. And it worked. It could have very easily exploded in my face. But for that one, they were like, yes, that's what we want. So take chances because they usually pay off. Don't always, but usually. Hello, sir.
Hello. My question is that a lot of anime are typically that it's based on source material like manga. Mm-hmm. Usually end well before the manga does in terms of the storyline. Are there any cases where you've actually gone and bought and read any manga that the anime are based on?
Unfortunately, I haven't had a lot of time to do that, but the one that we have used the manga for writing was Fairy Tail, because Fairy Tail follows the manga so closely, and a lot of times what happens in anime is, what people don't understand, is when it's translated and subtitled, your eyes can only read so much in so much time, so sometimes the translation comes up short as to what's actually being said, because it's not the full translation. It's like, hey, this is what we need for subtitles. So what we have to do is kind of fill in the holes with other information or kind of like flesh it out a little bit. So when we have source material like manga where we can go, hey, what did they say in the manga? Okay, well, maybe we'll add some of this back in. It really helps. But that's the only one. I have a bunch of manga. I just don't have the time to read it.
Yeah, it's kind of understandable considering the workload, I imagine.
I'm super busy, but someday I will get around to reading it and I will be a very happy lady, but right now it's just collecting dust in my office.
Cool. Okay.
Take care, Sudie.
You too.
Hi, how are you?
Hi, good, and you?
Good.
I'm going to bring up two really obscure animes that you worked on. Sure. Ghost Stories and Papua.
Yes, Papua!
How was like voicing those?
I can't believe you just said Papua! Baba, that was one of my favorites. If you guys haven't seen Papua, I don't even know if you can find it anymore, but it's old school and it is crazy. And it's about a little boy in a grass skirt. And yeah, it's fantastic. It was fun working on that. In fact, I still work with Kyle Jones over at Sentai now. And every time I get in the booth, even working on Majestic Prince or whatever I'm working with him, he'll be like, Baba. I'm like, yes, Baba. And that's how we start every session. Is it Papua? And what was the other one that you said? I'm sorry.
Ghost Stories.
Oh, Ghost Stories. Yeah, Ghost Stories is like a legend now. If you haven't seen Ghost Stories, if you're not easily offended, then please watch Ghost Stories. It's pretty fun. Thank you, Sadie. That was awesome. I'm running out of time, so we're going to go quick.
I'm sorry.
No, you're good.
You said you were into theater, right?
Yes.
What was the first musical / play you've been in?
Ooh, good question. The very first musical that I was... play. I did these plays that I did very, very early on, besides school stuff. When I was about 12 and a half, 13 years old, I was cast in a touring company. And what we did is we went to high schools around Texas doing these like public service announcement plays. So we did one called Not Me that was about drug use and... Oh. Tell me it's going to be wonderful about you know what and who says I can't drink and there's another one. Yeah. So I thought I was really, really cool because at 13 years old, I got to leave school for 2 weeks at a time and travel around in a bus and go to different high schools in Texas and perform.
Wow.
That was my first one. But my first like show that I did that was on my own was West Side Story. And I played Rosalia. Wow. Rosalia. Oh. So, yeah, but I've done so much since, so much Shakespeare and all kinds of stuff.
Oh, yeah. Do you prefer, like, classical or do you prefer, like, the newer stuff?
I tend to love my Shakespeare. Yeah, I'm kind of stuck
too,
in my Shakespeare.
I love it. Thank you so much,
sweetie. Yes, one last one and then we're gone.
I have to ask you the question when you were doing Rosario Vampire.
Yes.
How is Yukari's voice?
I loved playing Yukari. One of my favorite things about Yukari has nothing to do with the show, actually. We were at, when Pandy and Stocking premiered out at Anime Expo, Funimation had this loop of like different trailers and stuff that they would play. And so we would go up to the Funimation booth to take pictures for Pandy and Stocking. But this loop had this one line from Rosario plus Vampire, and everybody hated me by the end of it because it was Yukari going, I want you to be my girlfriend! Over and over and over. And they were like, Joel kept looking at me going, I was like, I'm sorry. But I absolutely love Yukari. She was super, super fun and super cute. And I love that she had problems with her breast size. So thank you guys. Thanks for coming.